You are now tuned in to Respect the DJ Podcast, coming to you live. Welcome to Respect the DJ Podcast. I am your host, DJ Junebug, alongside DJ Kared.
Yes, sir.
Today, we have one of Orlando's top DJs. You might have seen him on TV, on the Masters of the Mix. He's a Red Bull Music USA champion.
Yes.
You might have seen him touring with Kelly Rowland. DJ Manny Fresh said he's the best DJ around.
Damn.
Actually, the best DJ in the world, he said.
That's what he said.
DJ Jazzy Jeff said this boy is nice.
Nice.
Let's give a big round of applause for M Square.
Let's go.
Yo, thank y'all for having me.
You're welcome.
Thank you guys. Much respect. You know, this is an honor to be here. For real.
We're honored to have you.
Man, thank you.
Spend some time with us.
Yes.
Take some time out of your day.
You know, busy day. You know, I know you're very busy.
Absolutely.
And stuff like
but
that,
I always got to make time for the DJs. You know what I mean?
Yes, it's the platform for the DJs.
It's about the community.
Yes.
You know?
Right. Yes. Yes.
All right. So we're just going to go ahead and get this started. Same question we ask everybody because we all like to know, right?
Yeah.
How did you get your DJ name?
Well, my first and last name both start with M's.
Okay.
So that's literally where I came from, the name came from. But what was happening was I was starting to get bookings and I didn't have a DJ name yet.
Okay.
So I had to hurry up and come up with something.
Right.
Because I was hosting these events and the MCs on the mic would be like, leaning into me while I'm DJing, hey, what's your DJ name? And I'm like, DJ Mike.
You know? Right.
So I had to, it was just a matter of coming up with something quick. And I said, okay, first and last name, start with M's, M squared. Let's go. And it's stuck, thankfully,
yes,
you know, super grateful for that.
So that was your first pick of a DJ name or was it something
else?
Yeah,
that was my first pick. Yeah.
So you only got
and
one.
And it just stuck.
I tell people I had two before Corette.
Oh yeah.
June, I don't know if you had any.
I had two bugs. Bug.
So like it was spelled differently?
So yes, when I first went there it was B-U-double-G. So
okay.
Regular bug. Like everybody's cousins ain't bug.
Right.
So
yeah.
Cousin June bug.
Right, cousin June bug. When I moved to Florida, I met this other DJ. He's like, yo, you're in the South now, you know, you need that bug. So I was like, all right, B-U-H-G, I guess.
And yeah.
You know what I'm saying? From there on, it was like 95 for arms. B-U-H-G from there on.
Wow, man.
Yeah, mine was, my first one was Finesse.
Okay.
It has to do with my middle name, but obviously there was another DJ, Finesse. Then from Finesse, I went to Skills, and then I was in New York, and there was a Skills.
And, you know, both of those names fit you, actually.
Right, and like, then brother-in-law, I was like, yo, I need a name. And my brother-in-law, he was big in graffiti, in the graffiti time, Rocksteady Crew and everything else.
Oh,
and
yeah.
He took my name, and he's... So my name is Derek, and he just flipped it back and put Corette.
Brilliant.
You know what I mean? So I was like,
that's
brilliant.
I was like, yo, that's it. You know what I mean? It's me, right? It's my name. You know, can't take it from me type of thing. So I just stuck with Corette since then.
Bro.
Yeah.
Awesome story.
Yeah. That's my DJ names that I went through. I feel like we all go through a phase of names sometimes. You know what I mean? I think you got lucky. Not lucky, but you put some thought into it and came out with a great name and
thank you,
and
man.
Stuck
I appreciate
with it, you know?
That. I'm super grateful, man, for it to have stuck, you know, stuck and being able to like, resonate.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
It was different.
Thank you
know what I mean?
Yeah. Thank you.
And that's what it's about being a DJ is being different, standing out.
Standing out from everybody else.
You know what I mean? Having your
100%.
Own. Right.
So, 100%. Talking about basically DJ and stuff like that, was there any DJ to mentor you?
At the time when I started, no, I just self-taught. I didn't go to school for DJing. Went to Florida Atlantic University in Boca Raton, Florida.
Mm-hmm.
And I started playing parties in my room, like just playing music, really, not really parties. I had my door open in my dorm building. So anyone in the hallway
always partying
could hear me.
Right.
And they'd start coming out in the hallways dancing. I'd get in trouble from the RA, like, hey, the music's too loud. You know, you need to take out the sub bass. It's too much. It's shaking the building. And all of a sudden, someone from a fraternity was one of the kids in the hallway. Said, hey, you should come and DJ one of our parties, man.
Right.
You sound legit. So that's kind of how it started for me.
Right.
You know, it was really trial by experience. You know, one experience at a time.
Right. You're having your own party in the dorm room and
yes.
Everybody's partying in the hallway.
In the
that's how we all start in the room, man.
Yes.
That's where it starts at. So was there like a DJ that you saw? Like, what made you want to start to DJ?
Essentially growing up here in Orlando. I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York. But I grew up here in Orlando. So what made me really get started was hearing on the radio, the mix show DJs on the radio, like DJ Nasty here, DJ Pro Style, Jimmy Jams, DJ Caesar on 102 Jams. That was what like captivated me. I was a young teenager, young kid, and in my room literally recording the mixes on tape, on cassette tape, and listening to them back over and over and wondering, how is he doing these blends and these cuts, and you know, how does he get both records to go back to back like this? You know, when he's flipping, whether it's a old Brandy record or whatever it was, and I was just fascinated by that sound, and that's really, it was really like DJ Nasty that really captivated that experience for me.
Caught your ear,
yeah, it caught my ear.
Yeah, really during that time, let me see, early '90s, it was on Jimmy Jams. The Awesome Two.
Yes.
And I think Nasty and Caesar came on late 90s, probably.
It was because when Twice as Nice, when they changed the format of the station, is when they brought Stevie the Man in. And that's when they had, they kind of let everybody go. I think the only one that stayed around when they let everybody go was Jimmy Jams. Because they used to have Bartell, rest in peace, Bartell. And pretty much everybody that's on 94.5 right now was on 102 Jams. So like Monica May.
Wow, that's right.
And they were all on 102 Jams. And when they changed the format, Stevie the Man came in, and then they had like tryouts, pretty much.
Okay.
The best political way I say it, everything is who you know, right? So, you know, to an extent, they had tryouts or whatever it is. But and that's when Nasty and Pro Style got on the air. And that was, I have to say, 97, maybe 90, 98, maybe around there.
Yeah, that's about when I remember really, really like locking into 102 Jams like 24 hours a day. I'd be at school. The first thing I do is turn on 102 Jams when I come home.
It's crazy.
And press record on my cassette tape on the, was it the 5 o'clock traffic jam and the thunderstorm mix? I would be up all night just studying those
Jimmy
guys.
Jimmy Jams used to do the 5 o'clock. He was on there. And then Pro and Nasty started on the weekends, I believe. And then the slow jams was Bruce Beebox.
That's right.
Of course. You know what I mean?
This is Orlando history.
Orlando history.
Yeah, you know? Man.
100%.
So a long way. We're showing our age right now. You know what I mean?
Listen, I'm about to turn 49. It is what it is.
Yo, it's all wisdom.
Exactly.
You know?
Shit. Who was the first DJ or promoter to give you a chance and give you a shot?
So I have two. The first DJ to really give me a shot while I was at FAU was DJ Scoobs.
Okay.
He's based in South Florida. Amazing, amazing DJ. Does all of the big events down there. And he gave me a shot to do a barbecue event on campus. All the fraternities and sororities were going to be there. So this was like my big shot.
Right.
And I said, and I had a like a couple crates. And I said, hey, you know, would you mind if I came on and played a set while you're, you know, during your party? And he's like, man, I will. He's like, but the moment you do something wrong, I'm kicking you right off the set.
Right.
Like, so he's like, I'm going to give you a shot. Do your thing. So I had my records ready. And I remember specifically it was like a reggae set that I had.
Do you remember the first record you played?
Had to be like, I can't remember. It was one of the, like the Wally rhythm or
something like that.
Something like that. One of those buzz rhythm, one of those joints from back that time. Yeah.
Those are the hot rhythms back then.
Yeah. At that time, yeah. Bookshelf, you know, those rhythms like. And I remember he's like, all right, it's your turn. So, I mean, the place is packed. He put me on when it was packed.
Well, he was
at the peak of the day, party.
Then salute to him, because a lot of DJs will not give you that shot.
Absolutely.
They're like, yo, come early out and open up.
Right.
And we'll see what you could do.
He's drunk.
Right. He really put me to the test. And so I said, all right, this is my shot. So I came up there and I looked up a couple records in and the crowd was going crazy. And I looked over at Scoobs, and he was giving me like, keep going,
keep going. Yeah, you're like, doing your thing. Stop. Yeah, that's what's up.
And from that point on, man, he was like, you're rocking with me now. Like, all the parties I'm doing, you're gonna rock with me. So
with that Brooklyn vibe.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, it's part of, you know, the passion for me, the music.
Was that on vinyl or?
All vinyl. This is what this is way before Serato.
Let them know.
This is before Serato. Any sort of digital like software to spin or DJ with at all. I literally came in the hot sun with records to the party.
To the event, yeah.
You know, I had to get the dolly ready with all the records stacked on top of each other.
You didn't have good friends back then, huh?
Well, I did.
These are carrying my stuff. Carrying Karen's stuff back in the days.
Lucky man.
We'll go to the club. I got these, you know, 7 or 8 crates you need to carry.
So down. I don't know. Let's reverse on that. Cause just to go off topic, it was one time I was DJing at Roxy. They had the upstairs room, man, right? And I'm gonna say the names. Fuck it. So
we say everything.
Right,
here.
Right. So you one time, just to go, so we telling stories, right? We sharing our life. So I'm DJing, right? Cool. Night goes cool. End of the night happens. I got my cousin Joey. Shout out to my cousin Joey. And then my boy Ron, right? They was helping me with my records.
Okay.
So I'm cleaning up, talking to promoter. Yo, I'm getting my money, whatever. I'm out. They taking my records to my car, right? Yo, when I get downstairs, all my doors is open. The trunk, my Jeep, I had a rodeo. Records out in the open. Nobody around. And I'm looking at them, what the fuck that? They got into some beef. They chasing some dude through a parking lot. Just, you know what I mean? So my records, they ain't give a fuck about my records.
Well, I said carry records inside. I ain't about going outside. You know that's a different subject. You know
I was like, yeah, what the fuck y'all doing? Like, that shit wide open. I don't care what beef you got. This is my pride and joy right
that's
here.
The
you know
gold
what I'm
right there.
You know what I mean? Yeah, like, you know what I went through to get all these records?
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? But yeah,
that was a grind.
That was the good old days, man.
Yeah, it's a great story. Yeah, I mean,
I laugh at them. Every time I see them, I get on them about that shit. Every single time. Like, they not living it down for the rest of their lives, man.
So it was, Scoobs was the DJ that first like gave me a shot to do a live show. Then the promoter that really believed in me, he saw me at an event there on campus, actually, that I was doing. His name is, it goes by Dizzy D, Donnie Flores. At the time, he was promoting a lot of the big, like, celebrity events in South Florida, from South Beach all the way up to Palm Beach. And he heard me play an on-campus party and says, hey, man, do you do clubs? And I said, yeah, I'd love to. And he brought me on board as his, like, main DJ.
Okay.
So I was, at that point, going from doing on-campus parties to DJing for, like, 50 Cent and G-Unit.
Right away.
And then Nelly. And then Ja Rule, who was like on fire
at that time. Yeah.
Right. You know, so these are parties I'm doing because of this connection with Dizzy,
right,
who I'm, you know, super grateful for him believing in me early,
right,
and seeing that. So all the way from, like I said, South Beach all the way up to West Palm Beach while I was in college,
dope,
doing a lot of the celebrity events and parties throughout.
That's cool. We'll ask this question to everybody. So who do you think is more important, the promoter or the DJ?
Oh, man, I mean, you need both, man. You got they work hand in hand. I don't think there's a more important. I think you need someone to get the word out about who this incredible DJ is.
Right.
And just, hey, come see this talent. Come, you know, they have to fill, you know, like you say, put butts in the seats.
Right.
You know, that's important. Right. Although DJs can draw on their own as far as audience, I think it's important to have that healthy relationship between the two.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that's for the best outcome.
Right. That's the best way to put it, a healthy relationship.
That's a great answer.
That's been the best answer so far.
It has been.
Yeah,
it has. And we actually ask people who actually promote and DJ.
Oh, cool.
So, you know, we had DJ Caesar here one time. And
yeah, right, shout out to Caesar.
He does both.
So
yes,
he was like, and you know, he was like, the DJ at the end of the day.
Right, because he's gonna support the DJ. Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
So I understand that too.
Yeah.
But you're right that there's a healthy combination of a relationship there.
Yeah, it's important.
So a good promoter.
Yes, exactly.
A good,
upstanding person when it comes to business
who
and
your
ethics.
Money too.
Yeah, and respects you as an artist, not just as a DJ.
Right. Yeah, make sure that when you get there, all your stuff's in line, everything's ready.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's a major part of it.
So you've been on, well, you was on TV at one point on a show called Masters of the Mix.
Yes.
How did that all start for you? Did you submit a...
So at the time, I had just won the Red Bull Freestyle competition, became the number one DJ in America.
Say it one more time. We gotta let them know. Even though we know it's not you, you're humble. You're humble.
But here we
are.
I respect y'all. Give me the platform, man. Thank you. And so I became the number one DJ in America for Red Bull.
There you go.
Winning the Red Bull Freestyle competition for the United States. And
you were the...
touring.
You were the first United States champion.
Yes, the very first.
There we go. We got to be specific. Yes. You know what I mean? You got to let them know. You.
So from there, I began touring on behalf of Red Bull, going overseas, all throughout the United States, from Vegas to Miami. All the major clubs live, you know, everything in between. In getting a chance to see the world, you know, as a result of that. And the judges for that, by the way, were DJ Jazzy Jeff and Questlove, who really gave me the nod and the cosign after seeing me perform for the first time. And I was really, really honored, you know, to have that, you know, that stamp of approval.
Two big approvals that a lot of DJs wish they had.
Oh, yeah. People would pay money for that.
I'm super grateful for that. And while I was touring, my good friend, and he also works with me a lot on my team, LaShawn Curb, he sent me an email with a flyer that said Master of the Mix casting audition. And he's like, hey, man, you should really look into doing this. Now, I had just gotten off the win from the Red Bull. So I'm like, you know, these are really intense DJ competitions for people that don't understand like DJ battle culture and things like this. Like, these are very, very intense matchups that I had to take part in throughout. And they're different rounds and stuff, different parts of the country. And so I was kind of on my mode of like, all right, I'm just going to tour now and do my thing.
Right.
But he said, hey, man, this one's going to be on TV. You should really, really think about this and maybe audition.
Right.
And after a while thinking about it, I said, you know what, man? I'm just going to go do it.
Yeah.
And I took the ride to Miami at like 3 o'clock in the morning to line up, you know, thousands of, you know, other DJs that came there for that same opportunity.
Right.
They had us in like the, you know, long lines outside, you know, and inside was, of course, DJ Kid Capri, the creator of the show, and Jazzy Joyce, DJ Mars from Atlanta is also there. And of course, the executive producers of the show and the network heads and things were all there. And so we had to do one audition outside. And if you did well outside, then you could advance inside to like the DJ, like the Kid Capris, the DJ judges. So thankfully I made it past the outdoor audition. They said, okay, now you can go inside. They give you your sticker to wear on your chest.
Right.
And they said, okay, now you go in, you're going to audition for the actual DJs on the show. You have 5 minutes to rock them and impress them, you know? So I walk in and I see Kid Capri and I'm like, whoa, you know, he's a DJ, you know, exactly. So, you know, Kid Capri, big up to Kid Capri, by the way, legendary icon in this game. So come in and I set up and he says, all right, you got 5 minutes. Let's see it. You know, cameras are on, everything. This is it. So I start my mix. I started a blend. I did like an Adele thing that I mashed up with Missy.
Okay.
At the time, and as I'm in doing the middle of the blend, Kid Capri, I hear stop. This is literally like 30 seconds in, and my eyes got really wide.
I'm like, because like, what did I do?
Like, what happened? And then he starts to smile and he starts to clap. All the DJs start clapping. Everybody in the room starts clapping. They're like, we don't need to see any more. Come and get your ticket. You're going to Hollywood.
Oh, damn. That's what's up.
Yeah. I was like, man. Thank you. Walked up, got my ticket to Hollywood, and from there, that was like a kind of like an interim period where they kind of had you waiting for like, it was like a month that went by, you know, because you weren't really guaranteed. Someone from the network had to call you first to see if you actually made the cast. So a month went by, so I'm living my life. I'm back on tour again, back in Orlando doing my thing as well, and I get a call one day, and they said, hey, you've been selected to be one of the 11 cast members on Master of the Mix. Pack your bags, you're coming to Hollywood. Nice. Like the whole nine flew me out. Like, I think it was the next day.
Wow.
Yeah, they wanted to start right away production. So yeah, flew out to Hollywood, man, and was out there for a while.
How long was the filming? Was it like 2 weeks of filming?
No, this was like a couple of months.
Oh, wow.
Because the show was based on having us perform in the biggest party cities around America. So this was a traveling touring show.
Okay, so would you stay in Cali or would you fly home or
the base was Hollywood.
Okay.
So they had us up in Hollywood as the home base.
Right.
And then we'd get on a tour bus and go to each city individually via tour bus.
Okay.
So we got that experience as well.
Yeah, that's dope.
You know, 10 people or 11 people you don't know, never met.
Right.
Only thing you have in common is you're DJing, you're vying for this grand prize, you know, at the end, and you know, you're having to kind of basically live together until you're eliminated
Throughout
the competition. So it's super incredible experience.
And during this time, we had DJ Infrared too, right?
Was 2.0? He was on the season three. So I was on season two.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, he was after.
Yeah. So from there, you know, we went from city to city, and each city had its own particular challenge, you know, and then they had someone that was very, well-respected.
Like genre of music, right? Like
they'd say like, okay, so they had us in Chicago. Obviously, it was a house music challenge because we're in Chicago. So they'd have like, I think it was a Felix the House Cat was like the celebrity judge. Okay. So each city we'd go to, they'd bring like...
judge from that city.
Yeah, from that city that was like well-respected in the industry. Okay. As well as Kid Capri and Amber Rose, who was also a constant judge throughout the season, and also Victor Duplay, who was also one of the main judges.
Right.
And Just Blaze was the host of the show, right. producer Just Blaze.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When you saw that line the first time, did it feel like the movie Juice? When Q walks out in that long line of DJs?
Yes. That's exactly what it felt like. That's exactly what it felt like. 100%.
That's dope. Are you still touring now for Red Bull, and do you go to the competitions or?
So right now, I believe they're on like a pause now, currently for Three Style. And so I'm doing a lot of like private and corporate events.
Okay.
You know, at the moment and still, you know, from branded events as well.
Okay. So I guess they might have took a pause because of COVID maybe or just...
I believe they had a big part to deal with it. Yes. Yeah.
Right. Yes. So are you touring now for Remy Martin?
So right now, I'm doing a lot of special events as well for Remy. Yeah. So corporate, all of that. So speaking of, I... Come bearing gifts, guys.
Oh, we love gifts.
We love gifts.
Yes. So, on behalf of Remy Martin and the Remy Martin DJ Collective, I wanted to give the podcast and the hosts, here you guys go, 1738.
Oh, nice. Let's see what we got here.
Yeah. There you go. There's one.
Thank you.
Yes, yes.
Look at this.
My pleasure.
It's beautiful.
There it is.
Yeah. And you guys, that's how you come to respect the DJ podcast with gifts.
Yes. I got a lot to live up to now.
And you can actually take it out of the capsule here. If you'd like.
Let's crack it open.
Yeah. Look at that.
Nice. Clean.
Yes. Very beautiful. Thank you very much.
In the bottom is just because you could pour it correctly, right? You know that, right?
Sure.
See? What was that?
You know what I mean?
It's giving you game here.
You know what I mean? That's so you could grab it.
I ain't pouring this. I'm keeping this. Nah. It's going in my shelf.
I know Junebug pour drinks like this.
Oh. Listen, that's
we can't
drinks.
Do that. We can't do that with Remy. No way.
I might pour the P1 like that. You know what I'm saying?
You got to have your
This ain't getting poured. This thing actually to my collective, you know, I collect a lot of stuff. From music.
Yeah.
Hip hop, anything, even liquor. If I go like different countries and stuff like that, I give me a bottle from that country.
Yes.
You can't get it from the States. And I just... Having a cabinet.
Ah, nice.
And the wife's like, why are you always collecting stuff? That's just me.
Souvenirs.
That's it.
Why not?
That's why I am keeping this one.
We definitely appreciate that. Definitely
much respect, that. Guys.
We'll drink June's bugs and I'll take mine home.
We'll drink yours.
Yeah.
Well, we can finally open one.
Yeah.
We'll get another one.
No, you know what?
We have to plug now.
There you go.
We have to plug.
I'm super honored to be collaborating with such a prestigious brand as Remy Martin.
Absolutely.
And, and this collaboration, you know, with artists like Usher, who's now one of the brand ambassadors for Remy Martin, as you can see. And you know, I just have a lot of respect for, you know, for the collaboration. And
how did that come along, like, to collaborate with them? Did they reach out to you?
Yes,
or?
Yes.
Okay.
So Sharita Jackson from Remy Martin had reached out to me.
Nice.
And we started the collaboration, and it's been awesome. You know, we had special events in Miami over at Live, and it's just been great, man, and doing all these special events and much more to come as well.
Exactly. Yeah. And we talked about touring, too. At one point, you was touring with Kelly Rowland at one time.
Yes, yes.
How was that feeling?
So that actually felt incredible. And, you know, I actually got that call from my friend DJ Irie.
Okay.
In Miami.
Salute to Irie, absolutely.
So salute to Irie for that call. And that happened right on the heels of Master of the Mix. I was actually still taping Master of the Mix while she was in the middle of the putting the tour together.
Mm-hmm.
And I got an opportunity to work with her music director, who's also Beyonce's music director, does all her tours and everything. Her name is Kim Burse.
Mm-hmm.
So shout out to Kim Burse. I had the honor of collaborating with her on putting the show and the music together and sequencing
the actual
show. I was super honored to work with such an incredible artist as Kelly Rowland.
Her
dancers and her whole team, just great people across the board. And, you know, went out to Dubai and had an amazing shows, man. It was just incredible experience all the way around. Wow. Yeah, man.
That's a good time.
He went to Dubai to DJ.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
He didn't go to Orlando, downtown. He didn't go to Miami.
He went with Kelly Rowland.
You know what I'm saying? He went with Kelly Rowland. Yeah. Yeah. Dubai.
So, yeah, salute to you
much
for that,
respect.
Man.
Thank you. Up, man. No. Thank you, man.
So we noticed also weekly you're doing these mixes out on IG.
Yes.
Why inspire you to do that?
So I'm also a music producer.
Okay.
So I've been producing just as long as I've been DJing.
Okay.
So that is basically what I wanted to do with this presentation on social media with the producers is just to showcase and give them their flowers. These are the producers a lot of the time I came up studying as well.
Right.
And what I'm doing on social media is what I would do on my own time. I'd make CDs at the time, you know, back then, of all my favorite producers' catalogs to study their sound, to study okay. how they came across, you know, to the point that they are now musically,
right.
and the sound, how they came about their own sound. And guys like Timbaland, The Neptunes, Kanye West, mm-hmm. Just Blaze, Mark Ronson,
mm-hmm.
Ryan Leslie,
mm-hmm.
you know, these are guys I studied intimately,
right.
Their sound and their style. And that inspired me. And I thought about, you know, what could I do that could, one, give them their flowers and celebrate and honor them for their artistry, and also share that with my audience, the people that follow me
yeah.
on social media, and kind of show them, because that's part of my story.
Of course.
As a producer and a DJ. So I wanted to put those mixes together to show people, like, this is, you know, these sounds are important
to
the culture.
To culture, right?
Yes.
Without these sounds, you know, a lot of artists won't be around. We won't be around, you know.
Right.
That's right.
You know, without that great producer as well, the DJs won't have a record to spin.
That's right.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Without the beats, yeah. you know, we can't do the tricks and the double, you know, double backs and all that scratching.
So when producing, like, is there a specific genre or artist or producer you listen to draw inspiration from, or?
Yeah, it's from a variety of mm-hmm. different sources, all the way from Brian Eno, who mm-hmm. is more of a ambient focused producer,
right.
more like different sounds, all the way to, like I said, a Mark Ronson with the live approach,
right,
incorporating samples and hip hop with live music,
mm-hmm.
DJ Premier, Pete Rock, The Neptunes, mm-hmm. Kanye. Timbaland, Ivan Barrios, who's part of Carvin and Ivan,
mm-hmm.
The production crew. Mike City is a major influence on me as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just, it's such a vast array of producers that
right.
I respect and
right.
have studied from the very, very beginning of my inspiration and wanting to start making music.
Yeah, I think, well, when you listen to some of the tracks that you produce, you can see the eclectic style that you have. You know, it's not one style. You know, it's almost your own.
Thank you.
So I can definitely hear, now that you mention it, like the Mark Ronson and, you know, and things like that. Because, you know, Mark Ronson is a hip-hop head.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he's a hardcore hip-hop head.
Absolutely.
And in the songs he's produced, you would never even think, you know what I mean?
Put the two together,
right?
Yeah, he was one of the starters or founders of that mashup style, along with DJ AM,
mm-hmm.
rest in peace,
right.
who was also a major influence of mine.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Of mashing things like rock and hip hop together
right.
in the clubs, in a
yep.
hip hop club.
Right.
You know, playing things like Back in Black, AC/DC with Biggie, Hypnotize.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. they were in New York.
Right.
You know,
it was crazy because that record was actually sampled from KRS-One, Breakdown Production.
Yeah.
Sampled that years
yeah.
ago in the, you know,
right.
late 80s.
Exactly.
And, you know, nowadays you're like, they did that? Yeah, they did that.
Yeah.
They took that rock, they took those guitars, and
mm-hmm.
it was called Dope Beat, if I'm mistaken, the record was called.
I think so, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, KRS, yeah. So what do you use to produce? What's your go-to?
So I started out on outboard gear, right? So MPC 2000XL, which mm-hmm. I still use today. I started out with a Triton, then went on to a Motif.
Mm-hmm.
Then Ivan Barrios, who I just mentioned, mm-hmm. part of Carvin and Ivan, the production crew. You know, they produce like the huge, like, big hits, like Just Friends for Music Soul Child.
Okay.
You know, they worked with everyone. That Philly sound, that's yeah. Carvin and Ivan.
Okay.
I had the opportunity to reach out to Ivan back in the MySpace days, by the way. And he actually responded to me. And like I said, I study him all the time. And mm-hmm. he said, you know, send me some stuff. So I sent him some tracks. He's mm-hmm. like, man, this is like raw talent, mm-hmm. you know? And he's like, I can send you some of my sounds, you know, to kind of like beef up what you're doing.
Oh, nice.
He was nice enough to send me to like an library? Entire like hard drive of his
wow,
sounds.
That's amazing.
Invited me to his studio
in
New Jersey. And it was an incredible experience sitting right beside him,
right,
watching him. He's, you know, the song Half Crazy. Like mm-hmm. he was showing me how he made Half Crazy for Music Soul Child. Yeah. Playing it right there, playing these Michael Jackson acapellas he was working on at the mm-hmm. time, you know, for remixes and stuff like that. And so he's the one that told me about Logic, because at the time I was only using like an MP and Triton. So all my stuff was just being dumped out as like two tracks. I wasn't tracking anything.
Right.
So he says, hey, if you use like Logic, you can actually see everything mm-hmm. on a screen, and that helps you with arrangement and fleshing out ideas better. And from that point, I think that was like at Logic 8 at the time.
Okay.
And I've been using it ever since. I love it. I've tried all the other ones, you know, Ableton, right. FL Studio, and they're all cool in their own way. But to me, Logic's like the most intuitive and most like expansive DAW that I love. Flow, I love it.
Flows yeah. to you.
And yeah. I use controllers as well with Logic, like a MPD and a MPK 249, mm-hmm. things like that. And also use a Roland SPDSX. That's mm-hmm. The drum pads mm-hmm. that you use with the drumsticks.
Yeah.
As well as part of my production setup.
What about artists right now? I see you put out, is it out already? You put out a new single?
Yes, it just dropped on Friday.
Any artists you specifically working with? I seen that you put out a couple of projects before.
Yeah, so I had a big Latin single with Fito Blanco mm-hmm. and Noemi. Shout out to Fito. Shout out to Noemi. Mm-hmm. It's called Ganas.
Right.
And that was my first Latin record, all Spanish, the lyrics. So super honored to be able to collaborate with them.
Dope.
I just, like I said, recently released a record called City mm-hmm. That I produced, and featuring the legendary Viper
from Orlando.
Yes, mm-hmm. from Orlando. And Abeck, who's also from Orlando, right. Super talented. And they really, really laced the beat really, really well, man. I'm super excited and loving the positive feedback from everybody, man. And super grateful for that record.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's out now, you said, right?
It's out now, yeah. Stream it everywhere on all digital platforms, Spotify, Apple, Tidal, everywhere. YouTube, everywhere.
It's called City.
It's called City, M Squared featuring Viper and Abeck. Yeah.
So what DJ inspired you coming up?
The DJ that inspired me coming up was, I had two, had to be, it was DJ Jazzy Jeff and DJ AM together. Those were the two that really, really I studied. And I have to also, like I said, give another mention to DJ Nasty, because he's what he lit the fire for me. It wasn't, if it wasn't for Nasty, I wouldn't have discovered like the Jazzy Jeffs and the AMs and stuff like that. So
before you noticed even DJ Nasty, DJing wasn't even on your mind.
Correct. It was just, I knew the music gave me a feeling mm-hmm. and I didn't know how to express it. I knew I wasn't a rapper. I knew I wasn't a dancer in that way. So, but I understood that you know, there's a way to communicate using your artistry, you know, and I really wanted to figure out how I could get that out. I wanted to share that with people, like the same feeling that music gave me, like when you would hear Michael Jackson, I Can't Help It, the chords, the goosebumps that those chords mm-hmm. give you.
Yeah,
I wanted to figure out how I could share that with the world. Like, man, people have to hear this. Like, I have to get this out.
Right.
And there's some records out there that give you
that
back to life.
Yes.
Yeah. When you hear that intro, right, like, you know it's gonna happen. You know
and it's a simple track.
It's a simple track.
Yes,
but
you know when it's about to drop, forget about it.
Yeah.
That's where it started for me. I was on a journey to find what that was gonna be, and thankfully it was DJing and music production and putting the music together. I would study like album liner notes. That mm-hmm. was I was like an album liner notes enthusiast.
Right.
I'd sit there and read every single line, where they produced it, who was the engineer, mm-hmm. who was the producer, what right. studio did they make it at?
Who mastered it?
Who mastered it? These were the things that I was like locked in on when I was a kid.
Right. You can see that stuff back in the days with the vinyl.
Yes.
You know, I mean, I would love to get the vinyl because of the artwork and then open it up, you know, and look at who produced it, who wrote it.
Man. It was an experience.
It was an experience. Nowadays, every time. You don't get that feeling no more.
Yeah, it's hard to find. You have to go to, Wikipedia.
Wikipedia. Right?
Discogs.
To find out who sampled it.
Right, who produced it.
Yes.
Yeah, a lot of, you know, even now, you know, say 80s, 90s.
Yeah.
You know, we would look forward to certain producers and things like that. Nowadays, same thing too. The producers don't get the love that they used to.
I agree.
You know, because sometimes you don't even know who produced it. You have to Google it. Like, okay, who produced this?
Yes.
And also in the 90s, the producer, I didn't even have to read it, and I know Pete Rock produced it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Signature sounds.
So, yeah, those snares and those, you know, those.
The chops, the chops, sample chops.
You know, I knew it was SP-1200. You know what I mean? You just knew it was Pete Rock, or it was a Pete Rock remix, or, you know, Primo did it. You just, Easy Mo B, Buck Wild, you knew their style right away, so you knew that it was one of their tracks, which, unfortunately, I think a lot of the producers sound the same nowadays, you know, 808s. Yeah, a bunch of 808s, and they're not creating their own drums.
That's the era we're in right now.
Yeah, and I know Primo and P-Rock and all of them were stacking snares to create their own sound. Nowadays, people just buy a pack off of line and just use that. You know, I'm not hating on it because they're making a lot of money and that's what's up. But I think a lot of the actual art of it is kind of just dwindling away.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Especially at that sector of hip hop music, you know, of R&B. And I'm so glad to see like a new resurgence now. I feel like there's a R&B resurgence coming back, like the real coming back. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just really starting to like identify different artists like a Lucky Day.
He's fire.
Just so many just tight artists that they get it. You know, they get that sound. And they were also inspired by that sound.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that you were just mentioning.
Right.
You know, and I think that's important to keep that going for the culture, you know, as well as we have. There's a place for all of the like the commercial stuff, the really polished, you know, quickly produced stuff. There's a place for that too.
Of course.
But I think like the stuff that we came up on.
Yeah, there's not, I don't care, man. There's nothing like some Jodeci.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? There's nothing like that. You know what I mean? That there's at least nowadays, R&B is, they put R&B and hip hop into the same genre now, pretty much.
Everything falls into hip hop.
Everything falls into hip hop.
Doesn't matter what it is.
It hip-hop. Does.
And there's
it
no,
sounds different or it's hip hop.
That's why Adele popped because she came with a ballad.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? There's no ballads right now. There's no slow jams.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Who's releasing slow jams? Tank.
Right.
But if you don't know about it, but he got some fire. He writes for a lot of people.
Right.
Tank got some joints. Like, you know what I mean? You want to make some babies? Listen to some Tank. You know what I mean? And there are other artists, I can't remember right now, but there's no ballads on the radio.
Yeah.
You know, in the 90s, there was slow jams. You know what I mean?
It was such a good mix of variety. And another producer that influenced me that I have to mention as well is Dark Child, Rodney Jerkins.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Major, major influence on me and my sound.
Right.
And I've had the honor of meeting him as well. Over the years, and just super inspirational, super talented, just iconic, man. And he's someone that has contributed so much to R&B and the style of bringing pop and R&B and hip hop and like meshing it all together, the hard drums with the pretty chords, like that inspired me so much in my production style.
Yeah,
meshing those two together.
When Atiba was signed with Dark Child,
shout out to Atiba.
I don't know if you would. Did you go with us or we invited you? But we had an event at Rodney's house because you know he lived here.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
I don't know if I'm not sure if you went.
No, I don't think I linked up and did the first Atiba mixtape.
Right.
After that event.
Right. Yeah. So because a lot of people don't know that Dark Child lived here in Orlando.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
I didn't get the invite either. Don't worry about it. Once she got lost in the mail, probably.
It's still in the mail right now. Yeah, but
that's crazy.
Yeah, it's dope, man. So what about do Do you prefer vinyl or digital?
I have my reasons for different for each one. Okay. So like I prefer vinyl because of the feel. I remember when I would, you know, cue records up, I could literally feel the kick drum. Mm-hmm. I could feel the transient of the kick or snare on my, you know,
the touch. Yeah.
Yes. And I miss that.
Right.
With digital and MP3 and Wave and stuff like this that we're spending with Serato, which I love. Again, I'm not having to take 10 crates to the airport anymore. Right. You
and
know,
pay that extra fee.
Hey, there you go. Yeah. And so Serato has completely transformed the game, and I'm grateful for that. And the ability to have that convenience of having 20,000 records on your fingertips at right. any given time right. or more, and the variety that you can dip into as a
yeah.
DJ.
Yeah.
Now you can really, really give the people a show and give the people such a wider range of an audience, a wide range of music.
Music, yeah.
You don't have to just be focused on one genre. Right.
Especially
for
if you're DJing
hours.
Dubai, you know.
You got to be able to pull out all the stops.
Pull the stops, you can't stop.
I'm definitely miss vinyl, but sometimes because my ears are so sensitive, even still to this day, no matter with all the loud music I've been through, sometimes I hear the tone in the Serato. I don't know if you hear it.
Yes.
And that drives me insane sometimes. Because no matter how loud the music is, I still hear that tone.
That's amazing ears on you, by the way.
It drives me insane. Even if somebody's doing a mix, like on Instagram or something, I hear the tone before I hear the music.
Wow.
That's why I tell my kids, though. I hear what you're doing. I can hear. I don't care where you at.
I hear you.
I can hear an ant fart. Like, you know what I mean? It don't matter where you at or what you're doing, man.
Absolutely.
We also noticed a couple of times you used to DJ with a drummer.
So we're still a thing. The Mood Designers mm-hmm. is the name of the duo. So that's my friend, Natural Phil. He's to me one of the best drummers in the world.
Okay.
He's also toured in his own right as a drummer for some big major artists as well. And we started that together because we'd always collaborate from our connection at AKA Lounge mm-hmm. back in the day. Yeah, which rest in peace, AKA Lounge, you know, which was a like iconic venue here for the lounge vibe.
Right.
And we had a Sunday night there called Sunday Night Live with CeCe Tenille. Shout out to CeCe Tenille and the whole band, everybody there, all the poets that would come through and do open mic mm-hmm. and spoken word and stuff. It was an incredible night. We even had LeBron James come out one time to experience that night. And it was just such a great time to collaborate. Like, he was able to hear like the musicality in the way I DJ.
Okay.
And I started out as a drummer in middle school. Mm. So I always could hear the musicality and the passion and how he played as a drummer. And I said, man, this guy is different.
Right.
He's not just up there, you know, playing the sticks. Like,
yeah.
The way he lays into the drums, the way he lays into the grooves and the patterns that he was playing, I said, this guy's different, man. I got to link up with this guy. So just the mutual respect brought us together. Beyond just playing at the club there at the lounge at AKA, we would get together outside of that and do like studio sessions where mm-hmm. I'm making beats or DJing and he's just drumming next to me. I'm like, bro, this is dope. And at the time, DJ AM and Travis Barker had just started their collaboration.
Right. And you want a drummer, Travis Barker, yo, like he puts all his weight. If you watch him play drums,
yes,
he's practically standing up. Like he's a beast for sure.
Correct. Yeah. And I love that kind of power.
Oh, yeah.
To see the snap, drummer play. Yeah, that kind of power. And that's what I saw in Phil as well. And I said, man, you know what? This could actually be something, you know, like live. Maybe we could do this. We saw what AM and Travis were able to do and how like fascinating people were that it was that mm-hmm. you know, they were out doing like these major events as a DJ and a drummer. So much respect to that duo for kind of like birthing that collaboration. Yeah. And that inspired me and Phil to do our thing as the Mood Designers. And that's how we began, and we've gone on to do some major events. We headlined the NAMM showcase in Anaheim, California.
Mm-hmm.
We had the opportunity to do that, and we've also performed as the NBA halftime performance twice, actually, here for the Orlando Magic at the Amway Center.
Dope.
So it's been incredible. We've also released our own original music. mm-hmm. as well. So that's available on all the platforms. We had a record called Troll mm-hmm. That we did. And shout out to S.K. S.K. And he featured on it. He did the lyrics and everything. And it's just like, we're like brothers now.
Right.
You know, and when we get together, it's like deeper than, you know, when Rick Ross says deeper than rap. It's like, yeah. It's deeper than the music for us when we link up and we just connect. And that translates in the music whenever we're in the studio together.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
You talk about AK Lounge. I remember when me and Carell at AK Lounge, we was a DJ in the kitchen. Remember that?
Really?
The there was no stage.
Right.
There was no wow. There was nothing. We were in the back room.
Oh, man.
There was like an like open, remember it was the open pole where they served the dishes from?
Yep.
And behind there was a steel counter.
Right.
And that's why I turned the table. Was wearing
that's everything. Amazing. I never knew. The thing that got me when I was at AKA was they had a swinging DJ booth.
Yeah, I used to hate that.
From the ceiling.
I used to hate it.
Yeah, and we were on vinyl.
I thought it was cool at first. I was like, oh, yeah. Wow, this is pretty cool. But then when you get up there and that shit starts, like, you getting into it and it just starts.
That would have been good for some groupie shit. I don't know.
But yeah, that's another podcast, shit. Yo. Like, you know? That's a whole totally. Other podcast.
You know, at that same time, though, I was actually a part of a crew here locally called Locksmith Entertainment. Mm-hmm. And that was like our hub was AKA Lounge.
Right.
We had a Wednesday there.
Yeah.
And it was called Rock the Mic Wednesdays. Mm-hmm. That was more for the hip hop community.
Right.
So all of the MCs would come out. We'd do the battle raps. Mm-hmm. We'd do the performances. We would do our own showcases. So Locksmith, we started throwing our own events
right.
out here in town and started to build our own following.
Right.
From just doing the parties from downtown all the way to Altamont. We were just going to various places throughout Orlando to get the word out there.
Yeah.
We went on to do a showcase for Sirius XM Radio, Satellite Radio, mm-hmm. on Cypher Sounds and Angela Yee's show. Okay. And I produced a record called Can't Be Your Man that all the members of Locksmith was on, C-Style, mm-hmm. Disaster, and D-Light. Mm-hmm. And there was a segment called Don't Quit Your Day Job. And we submitted for that, and we actually ended up winning that competition on Sirius XM on Cypher Sounds, the Angela Yee show. So that like really, really gave us a lot of motivation,
right?
You know, to keep at it, you know. And over the years, obviously, people, you grow and you start to get into different parts of life and
right,
you know, different professions and things. Yeah, like you kind of. So
it's the same thing. Like, and we said this plenty of times before. Me and Jubug. Since been rocking since 93.
Oh my goodness.
A lot of
man.
People don't know that.
I didn't know us.
Because, you know, they don't really see us together. But like you said, sometimes, you know, you just do separate things and you grow, you know, you have kids, you have families, just mm-hmm. life kind of happens. And we've always been in touch. You know, he's yeah. always looked out for me. Junebug put money in my pocket.
Wow. Man.
Plenty of times, you know what I mean?
Much
so
respect.
It's
Much
just.
Respect.
It's just you never know. You know what I mean? And sometimes when you come back together, it's even better than the first time. You know what I mean?
That's
so
true.
So that's what's up, man. You know, yeah. getting on Sirius and having those little things like that. But going back to before I forget, you know, speaking about drummers, because I like to give people their flowers. There's a young lady on Instagram. I don't know if you ever seen her. She called
Pocket Queen.
The Pocket Queen.
Oh man, yeah. I've been following her for a long time.
Yeah,
man.
She's. I suggest
she's
anybody, if you like drumming, like you know, you like Questlove and you love those things like that.
Yeah.
Make sure y'all follow she's called the Pocket Queen.
Yeah. Yo. Definitely follow
she's
her.
Insane, yo.
Yeah, she is incredible. I saw her doing, I think, the theme song, like the Martin theme song, and playing along with that.
Was, mm-hmm.
Man, her pocket is just insane.
She's in there. Yeah. And smooth.
Yeah.
It's like no effort.
And she's just looking at the camera.
Looking at the
smiling.
Camera. Yeah, not even. She don't look at the drunk. Yeah, she's going in there.
Yeah, just insane.
Yeah, man. I see you DJ for, and I don't know, are you still doing it for Universal Studios for New Year's Eve?
Yeah, so just, I had a long-standing residency for, I'd say, about 7 years mm-hmm. with NBC Universal. And I would do all of their major headlining events here, from mm-hmm. all the private events all the way to the public events, like New Year's Eve.
Right.
So they started that concept once I started the collaboration with them, and they wanted to kind of bring something different to the table for New Year's mm-hmm. Eve. And I was super excited
right.
about being a part of that and
yeah.
Watching that grow and be you know, collaborating with them was mm-hmm. super incredible, you
yeah.
know, just to be able to see the way they, I remember being in the board meeting with the executives there, and they had the like 3D rendering on the table of what
professional,
the stage
right?
would look like and what the DJ booth is going to look like. And, right. you know, I gave my input and things like that and my team as well. And we built that entire show, you know, together from, you know, the pyro times Our and time. Things like this. And yeah, just the coordination. Yeah, it was a really big live show. You know, we've done, you know, thousands and thousands of people over the years, man. And so it was a very, very exciting run. And then I went on to be the main headliner for their Saturday nights at The Groove, which was their main nightclub there. And that was also an incredible run, being able to DJ for, you know, again, thousands of people from all over the world.
Right.
Every single week. It's new faces.
Yeah, I'm sure that was a tough crowd, though.
New countries, new, because... you know. Actually, it was, it wasn't. It was, they were so receptive.
Okay.
Because they didn't know what to expect yet.
Not only did they come to party to have fun.
And they, yeah, they're there They're not there to stand against the wall.
Or,
right.
No, they wasn't like Bad Bunny, like on their phone, like playing.
Oh, no. Well, some people definitely had the phone thing going, which, hey, I don't mind. You know, that's content. You know,
right.
So, yeah, just tag me. You know. But they have such a variety of people, and it was such a nice big room, you know, we could fit thousands of people in there, two levels at the time. And, you know, they actually also built that live show up over the years while I was a part of that crew. And, you know, from the LED walls to the actual DJ structure that I was performing on, these guys were like super focused on providing that experience.
Right.
Not just for me, but for the audience so that it comes across.
Right.
So when I'm DJing, it was like, you know,
you're
top.
You're the artist, you're the DJ.
Right.
You guys focus on that platform.
Yeah, you're
making it a real show, not just a club night.
Right.
You know, we had the CO2 and the confetti and just that entire experience, almost like Vegas.
Yeah.
Like it felt very much like a Vegas experience. Yeah. And that's what we always aimed for, you know, a lot of the time. So,
Yeah, that's the best thing. I know when the times I used to do Beecham sometimes on Saturday.
Yeah.
And the Beecham kind of step my level up also, because you know the Beecham, they have you right in the main stage, the front, and they have the lights and everything, you know, on you. And then you have some venues that have the DJ tucked away in a corner.
Oh yeah,
you know what I mean. And so when you get to experience those two, it's like, you know, you want that feeling of everybody looking on you, because then you can see the crowd.
Yeah,
you can control it and see, okay, I went into this song, but all right, it's not really working. Let me get up out of this, you know, faster than being tucked away in a corner somewhere where you can't experience what's going on.
You know what moves to make.
Right.
It's like an impulse. You can, in real time, make these like executive decisions as a DJ.
Right.
And say, no, I want to go left now. Or like, I want to throw a curveball at him and see.
What happens.
Yeah, see what happens. Yeah, and that's what makes it fun.
Yeah, and the same thing, like I said it too plenty of times here in the podcast and stuff, that to me, DJing, especially for a live crowd and doing a club or whatever it is, like playing chess.
Yes.
You know, I already know I'm four songs ahead of five songs of what I'm playing right now. I know where I need to go. Okay, if this song works, then the next three songs are going to be these next three. And if this one doesn't work, then I need to take a different route.
There you go.
And people don't understand. They think you're just going up there and you're playing music. If you're a good DJ, you're ahead. You know, sometimes I'm even like, okay, I'm going to close the night with this.
Yeah.
And it's 10 o'clock. I'm just like opening up. I'm closing with these right here.
I love that.
You know what I mean? And a lot of DJs, I'm not going to say a lot of DJs, but some people don't do that. They just go up there and they just create a playlist at home and they stick to it whether the song works or not.
Exactly.
I don't know if you've seen that before.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. You know, I think you have, it's a very fluid situation. So it's hard to have like a set thing going in. So it's important to have some sort of like call and response. Like you need a pulse to kind of go off of. And that's what the crowd's going to give you. That's what the room is going to give you.
Right.
You know, I always say like before a show, I like to get to the venue like 2 hours before so I could settle into the vibe of the room.
Right.
All that stuff matters. Every little intricate detail matters when you're about to perform and jump on that stage. You know, because you're there. Those people paid their money, their hard-earned money, to come and see you perform.
Right.
And, you know, I take that, you know, very, very highly, you know, and with a lot of respect. So that's how I like to approach it, you know, and give them a show.
Yeah.
You know, every single step of the way.
Yeah. Right. I think you can get there with some sort of plan, but you always have to be able to pivot. You know what I mean? Don't get stuck with that plan, and this is it.
Yeah.
And, you know what I mean? And yeah, I definitely feel what you mean, like the energy and the just the vibe of the venue and just watching people as they get there.
Yeah.
You know, I like to listen. If I'm closing, I like to listen to the opening DJ. I like uh-huh. those things like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Speaking of opening DJs, with this new culture of like more and more DJs and the accessibility to equipment and things like this, more and more DJs are getting opportunities. Mm-hmm. I just want to share something that DJ Green Lantern shared with me mm-hmm. when I had the opportunity to collaborate with him mm-hmm. On a couple of shows. Told me there's an art to opening.
Yes, there is.
As art. A DJ.
Yes.
And I've always, that always stuck with me, and I, right. and I've always respected that.
Yeah.
No matter what the scenario was.
No.
There is an art no. to opening for that's, another DJ.
That's the toughest job.
Yes.
Closing is cakewalk.
Yes.
Everybody's drunk.
Everybody's drunk.
Yeah.
But, you know, they popping bottles, they getting there late, right. you know, and you're going
to
play
trying
the hits.
Trying to keep everybody there?
Trying to get everybody to start drinking and keep them there. So a lot of people don't respect the opening DJs. The opening DJs have the toughest job.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And you have to, like, you know, you got to curate those 2 hours that you're opening
exactly
to keep people in there.
Yes.
And buying bottles.
And building the night up.
And building the night up.
Yeah, it's like an arc. You know, you have to continue. It's a continuous build.
I call it a like an emotional journey.
Yeah.
You got to take people on that journey. You know, it's a slow rise.
Yeah.
And you get to that point where the opening DJ is going to come on. I mean, I'm sorry, the closing DJ is going to come on and do that thing. So.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's not easy being an opening DJ.
Respecting the DJ.
Yes. Yeah.
You mentioned yeah. earlier about Matters, Congrats on My Journey, but I think you're the only DJ, let's say wrong, you could drive to Orlando at one point and there's a big picture.
Big mural.
Big mural of M Square.
Yep.
Nobody done that.
Oh, man. Thank you so much, like, yo, man.
One, we salute you.
Yeah,
here.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
You know what I'm saying?
Thank
I mean, that's
you.
Like...
Maybe we could be on that wall.
Well, maybe.
Oh, with man. The podcast, yeah, with you the know podcast, what I'm saying?
Yes. I'm honored, man.
But
I'm
yes,
honored.
To have to drive down downtown and... What was that feeling to see that mural up?
It's, man, it's humbling, man. It just being that I grew up here mm-hmm. in Orlando, and the love and support that I've gotten from the community here right. has been overwhelming. And I'm super grateful to everybody that's ever came to a show or the club or given me an opportunity here, whether you're a promoter or private party, events, corporate, across the board. I'm mm-hmm. super grateful. And thank you to Red Bull for giving me the mural, mm-hmm. rewarding me with that mural. That was a part of a competition. You know,
was it like a voting type of thing?
Yeah,
or?
Okay. Yeah. And the community voted. So that's why, you know, it's
right.
such a heavy thing, heavy honor, high honor for me to have that achievement.
So we could just say you're the people's choice.
Hey,
people's
man.
Choice. The city's choice. Hey, got a new record called City.
You know what I mean? Right. Absolutely.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Shit. Is there like yeah. a single night out DJing or concert or something that you've been to that you always reflect on or had a great time at?
Let's see. It's a good question. Yeah, I mean, probably like one of the New Year's Eve shows that I've done.
Mm-hmm.
Just thinking back, I mean, just the sea of people that you could just see from going all the way back through the complex,
right?
You know, just seeing just the ability to play so many different genres of music and touch so many different people at right. one time and have them all on the same page, dancing and moving and excited, you know, having the time of their lives. That's
right,
what I
right.
that's what I aim for at every event I do, yeah. is to give them that memorable experience where, you know, I want them to leave, you know, with that feeling like, wow, man, that was incredible.
Yeah. It wouldn't be yes. Kelly Rowland?
Well, that was one of the many moments. I mean, obviously, yes, rocking with Kelly was an incredible experience.
Right, but you have others.
Yeah, I mean,
after
there's,
that.
There's
yeah.
so many. But yeah, being able to go overseas and see people that don't speak the language sing the lyrics back to us
right.
in English, it was just mind-blowing. Thousands of people just appreciating the music and the culture over there, man. It's just
yeah. I think it turns into an adrenaline rush. You want to okay. How can I top this?
Yeah.
You know what I mean. So
every time. Even yeah. like I said, moments from like Master of the Mix when I had done one of the challenges was you had to play to a full house crowd, but there's a white wall in front of you. Mm-hmm. So you can't see the crowd, but they can see you, but only your silhouette. Oh, so you're having to perform for 5 minutes and rock this crowd that you can't see. And they threw in a curveball and said, hey, you have to play in your set. You have to play Loretta Lynn's Coal Miner's Daughter.
Okay.
Which is a country record.
Right.
And this is a hip hop show or hip hop R&B, you know, mix show. So you had to figure out a way to work that into your set. And thankfully, I won that competition.
Yeah.
You know, being able, because it's a feeling thing for me. Like, of course. When I perform it, I don't need to even see them.
No.
I just got to feel the room. Right. And I know exactly where to take them.
Right.
You know, from there. Once I get that energy, like, I know exactly where I need to take them. So moments like that stick out to me as well, you know, from different phases of my career that I could think of that give me that.
Yeah.
That feeling.
That good feeling. Like, yeah. Like, oh, I did that. You know what I mean? Those are great, great feelings. Going back a little bit, do you remember the first record you bought, the first vinyl?
Yes. I remember I bought it from two. It was Carib Craft, right? That was, was that the name of it?
That was in downtown. Downtown. Off Church Street, yep.
It was the Rice and Peas Rhythm record.
Okay.
The double disc.
Uh-huh.
And I love that rhythm so much, I would just play that for hours and go from record to record to record to record. And that I believe that was the first vinyl I got, was mm-hmm. the Rice and Peas Rhythm.
You still have your vinyls?
Some. A lot of them I ended up selling, and mm-hmm. you know, but I still hold on to, like, the ones that have very, like, sentimental, you know, feeling to me. You know, I still have my Groove Theory first album LP on vinyl.
Right.
You know, shout out to Bryce Wilson, Amel LaRue. Like, that sound, that moment, you know, would tell me, and that was an incredible
That was big
moment.
In hip-hop.
Yeah, in hip-hop, man. Yeah. And that feeling that those records give me, man, it's like, that's what I'm talking about. That's why I do this.
Right.
I can listen to that album from front to back, no skips.
Right.
Just let the record go, turn it over, next side, go again. Let's see, Music Soul Child's I Just Want to Sing.
Yeah, classic.
That's another one that I always have to hold on to. Jill Scott, Who Is Jill Scott, the very first, her first release.
Right.
You know, that's a lot of the sound that inspired me as a producer as well. You know, I wanted to go to Philly when I was in college. I didn't even want to go to FAU. I wanted to go to Temple. Because of the sound.
Right.
I said, I need to be there. Wherever the sound is coming from, that early 2000s, late 90s, Philly era with, like, Music, Soulchild, Glenn Lewis, and Flowetry, and Dre and Vidal, the producers. Mm-hmm. Again, Carvin and Ivan. That motivated me so much to want to be in the space where that was happening.
Rafael Sadiq has a similar sound.
Absolutely. Rafael Sadiq has a major, major soulful sound, you know, with the swinging, the hard swinging drums, you know, with the pretty chords and the nice chord changes and the groovy bass lines. And that's what, like, really got me, you know, hooked, you know, when I started producing and all that.
So working with so many DJs and so many artists, who is one DJ or artist you have not worked with yet and you want to work with?
Wow, that's a great question. There's so many. Let me see if I could put it out there into the world. I'd say
in the universe,
I'd say Mark Ronson. I haven't had a chance to work with him yet. I've met him a couple of times. I had the honor of, you know, speaking with him and communicating with him. But I'd love to work with him, like, in the studio.
Producing.
And produce, absolutely.
And DJ?
Anybody? DJ-wise, let's see. Wow, who would I? Because I'm super grateful. I've had the chance to rock with a lot of my heroes.
A lot of greats,
A lot of my heroes I've had the chance to share the stage with, man. I'm super grateful. Let's see. I'd probably say DJ AM, man. Rest in peace. I know he's no longer here, but that's who I would want to share the decks with, man. That, you know.
Yeah.
Very, very instrumental in, like, what moved me to want to, like, my sound as a DJ, my style.
Styles.
Yeah, AM all day.
any mistakes you see upcoming DJs do that you was able to sit them down with them and speak to them? What were you telling them not to do?
You know, they're just, everyone's on their own journey, you know, in their own path. So it's like, who am I to say, like, you're making a mistake? And you know what I mean? Like, at the end of the day, I think it's important for DJs to learn through experience too. Right. So I would just say, just look, study the greats and look at what they're doing and try your best to emulate that.
Right.
And find your own voice, find your own way over the years, over the time that you, you know, as long as you take this seriously and you take the craft seriously, that's my main focus. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to fall short. You know, you're going to play the empty rooms.
Yep.
You know,
Or clear the room.
Yeah. It happens to everybody.
It's important to stay the course through that journey. You know, if it's a slow climb, let it be a slow climb. You know, stay motivated, stay focused on your craft,
right,
and let the music speak for itself.
Right.
That's how I would, you know, address that.
And what about the music scene right now? What, anything that bugs you about it?
That's a good question. Not really. I kind of like where things are going as far as like social media, how much that's incorporated into what we do, like our everyday moves.
Right.
I kind of like it now. You know, initially I didn't understand it because we came from an era before social media. We had to pass out flyers, right, like we had to do posters and things like this. And I think the live aspect, the way things are going now, needs to change. Something needs to change, like as far as the touring side of it,
right,
because artists are having to cancel shows and things like this because of budgetary issues and tour support, you know, crew, you know, man's, you know, crew power, things like that,
right,
to be able to have that kind of support. I think something with the infrastructure could be changed as far as touring goes.
Right.
That's the first thing that kind of sticks out to me. Right. But I like where things are as a whole. Really comes to like social media and having to like put yourself out there and being able to find your own audience, doing your thing. You no longer have to do what this person is doing to get on or trend this way or trend that way. There's literally someone that will vibe with exactly what you do.
Right.
And then, you know, like nowadays, the music, the songs, that's the lifespan and so short now.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like before. We got records that are classic that we still play in the club nowadays.
Yeah.
And they still rock. Compared to now, you got 2 or 3 months maybe a life.
Yeah.
And then after that,
yeah,
the next song is hot.
Yeah, the attention span is terrible now.
It is. It is. I mean, that's just where we are right now.
Yeah, yeah. You know? It's the TikTok, you know, Snapchat.
But
it's crazy, the TikTok, if you listen to some of the songs that are actually getting picked for dancers, for the dancing portion of it, it's a lot of old school records.
Yeah, of course.
That's true. And they like speed them up.
They speed them up.
Stuff.
Yeah, they speed them up. They
slow them down.
They give them new life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not the new records.
No, no.
It's not the new records doing it. It's the old records.
The challenges, the dance challenges and stuff like that.
Dance challenges. I mean, even the top hits right now, the top 10, 20 records are samples from, you know, the 90s, 2000.
Yeah, that's another thing. Everyone's like going back 10 years now. Like as a producer, it's almost like I would feel like, oh man, I can't touch that. That was too soon to sample.
But think about it from the era we came up on. You know, I'm a little older, but you know, 80s did the 70s, 90s did the 80s, 2000 did 90s.
Yeah,
we're almost 2023.
We're there now. Yeah,
we're there now. So you think about,
you could do some 90s joints here.
You could do 90s joints, some early 2000s.
Early 2000s stuff. 2010 stuff.
Yeah. That's 20 years. I mean, it don't seem like we've been this era for 2020.
Wow.
Because, you know, we lost 2 years.
Yeah.
But, we're in 2023 almost. So think about it. It's that time to sample now that generation.
Yeah, it is.
Is there a genre of music that you listen to that no one would expect?
I think I would say, yeah, I delve into a lot of like subgenres of electronic music.
Okay.
Artists like Fortet.
Mm-hmm.
I really dig into even house like Mark Farina.
Mm-hmm.
I'm huge Mark Farina fan. I listen to Mushroom Jazz probably most of the day.
Mm-hmm.
his Pandora station is like locked on my phone. That's literally all I'm playing. And
right.
And like my recreational listening vibe when I'm not in focus mode as a DJ listening or producer listening.
Yeah, you're chilling.
I'm chilling. I love the down-tempo stuff. Mm-hmm. That's the stuff I really, really enjoy as just a music fan first.
Right.
Of course, the throwbacks, like the classics, like the Michael Jacksons, mm-hmm. The Groove Theories, mm-hmm. the Jill Scotts, the old school hip hop stuff, the Premier and Pete Rock mm-hmm. Produced type stuff, all the boom bap stuff, man, that everybody loves, the Wu-Tangs.
Yeah. And
the, let me see. Man, there's just so many different genres I like to dive into.
I think being a lover of music, you're always looking for something new.
Yes.
You're always looking for something to inspire you or something, a new artist or something to really listen to.
Yeah, and I dive like really, really deep. And I'm sure you guys do the same thing as DJs.
That's what I do. I mean, for sampling and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I look in deep. I mean, when I leave a club, I don't want to listen to hip hop at all, first of all. That's the first thing.
Yeah, so when you leave a club, you do an event, and you drive home.
Silence.
Right, yeah. That's what we always say.
Silence.
But you don't want to hear nothing.
Like a Sunday when I'm home, to chilling.
Right.
I mean, I'll put some Bee Gees on.
That's that cleaning music.
I ain't cleaning. I'm just resting, I'm cleaning my soul. That's what I'm doing. I'm cleaning my soul.
Right.
That's what I'm doing.
You know,
but some Bee Gees music, stuff like that, you know.
Yeah.
Evelyn Champagne, stuff like that.
There you go.
That's my, you know, that's what I go to.
Chill music. Yeah, I go back to my childhood, especially on Sundays.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm that parent that wakes the kids up on Sundays and I got salsa music blasting.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Playing some old school.
some
old school salsa classics.
Nice.
And my kids go crazy. But
dad's up.
Yep.
They know
he's
it.
Cleaning. You know what I mean? He's doing something. But
that's the sound. I mean, yeah, so many artists like even like Slack of the Beach Child, like these are, you have to dig to find a lot of this stuff.
Yeah.
You know, but to me, that's what I love. That's my go-to stuff.
Right.
When I'm listening for music to just relax and chill to or drive to, it's that, you know, those type of artists.
Right. If I want to get crazy, I'll put some Queen on.
There you go.
I'll start with some like Metallica or something you know what I mean? Just going ham with that shit like that.
Yeah.
You want to get freaky on a Sunday morning? Put some Bobby Brown on.
Some Bobby Brown.
Yeah, I'll even go like to Dave Matthews Band.
Right.
Like all that stuff, man. Nirvana even. You know, a lot of that alternative stuff is what I grew up on, along with reggae music in the house, you know. I would say, like the Stone Temple Pilots mm-hmm. stuff. And that's what like grew on me when I was a young kid,
right?
And then kind of hip-hop after that is that's kind of when I discovered like the hip-hop
bats.
The boom bap stuff after that alternative grunge mode or that time frame.
Yeah,
but that's what kind of like I was locked in on first as a kid, like Stone Temple. When I first heard Plush by Stone Temple Pilots, it's like a crazy experience. I can't even describe it. I was speechless.
Yeah. Then you dig in for more stuff like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. I couldn't believe. I said, "What is?" It was so soulful.
Right.
You know the man.
Yeah. So much.
That record was so soulful to me. Every time I hear it, like it stops me in my tracks. If I'm like at a mall or the grocery store and Plush comes on by Stone Temple Pilots, I have to stop what I'm doing and just take it in. That's one of my favorite like rock alternative records of all time.
I think you're ready for some games, right?
Yeah, let's break it up a little bit.
All right.
Play some games. I don't know if you're ready for these, but
okay.
So what you want to do first?
Let's do the choice is yours.
All right.
Club party, house party, or corporate party?
You're getting paid the same amount of money. They fall on the same day.
Ooh.
You have three different people call you. Yo, I got this event. But it's at a club. Oh, I'm doing this house party. Oh, I got this corporate event.
Corporate event, man.
Corporate event.
Because they come to party, man.
They get mad drunk.
With that, and I'm sure when you give your rider what you want is there when you show up.
100%.
The blue M&Ms, you
100%.
Know what I'm saying?
The sparkling water.
Right, the boss.
Well, actually, there will be no sparkling water.
There will be Remy Martin.
That's right.
1738. You know what I mean?
Shout out to Remy Martin.
All right, so here's a controversial one.
Okay.
Which one? I was going to say order of importance, right?
Okay.
Let's do it this way. Bartender, bottle girl, or a groupie?
Order of importance as to what? Like, what's the context? Like, when you say...
To you.
Like,
the way you're feeling that day.
Your opinion, yeah.
The bartender, man. Like, they're like the first point of contact, the first point of communication mm-hmm. entry at the bar. Like, you have to be personable. You have to know how to communicate. Mm-hmm. They have a very important role in the nightclub or any event in setting the vibe just as the DJ sets the vibe.
Right.
You know, they have to know when someone's drinking too much. You know, they have to have that kind of responsibility on right. them to say, hey, no, I can't do
like,
that.
You're good. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, you're good. You know, so I have a lot of respect for bartenders.
I think it's a good bartender.
Yeah, a good bartender.
You know,
because
if you frequent a venue or you as a DJ, they say you have a residency somewhere and the bartender sees you as soon as you show up there, already got your drink for you.
There you go.
You know what I mean? So, yeah.
There you go. And they play off of you as a good bartender understands how the DJ works.
Right.
And they understand that it's important for a DJ to kind of rotate the room because it's also something to keep the DJ on the crowd, the dance floor for too long.
Mm-hmm.
And now people aren't drinking. So they understand when right. a DJ can rotate the room and let it like evolve naturally throughout the night instead of just playing bangers all night and just keeping everyone on the floor the entire, no one's drinking.
Right.
So they have a good bartender has that same respect for a good DJ.
Right.
You know, so I like to share that and give that back right. to the bartender.
But you're also serving your groupie, St. Tom.
Well.
By DJing.
Yeah. By DJing.
Yeah, that's part of it.
Even though I'm saying a good groupie is a good groupie.
They bring problems.
They bring problems. Even the church girls are groupies.
Oh, man.
We'll get M Square in trouble.
Yeah, fine. Yeah.
No comment.
Let's get into that sampling real quick.
Sampling? All right.
Smoke, you ready?
So we'll explain it to him real quick. We're going to play the original song, the original.
Okay.
And then you have to tell us who used it. It could be the producer or the artist.
Oh, okay. All right.
It's quicker than quick.
Well, you guys know I was on Beat Shazam, right?
Okay.
Yes,
with Jamie Foxx.
I tuned in.
Oh,
for that
perfect.
One.
Okay, I'm glad you guys
see
saw
that.
It.
So let's see if you could beat let's the see. Sample.
Okay, I love that.
All right, so play the first one. Yep.
That's either X by Exhibit.
No.
That used that. Dun dun dun. Yeah. Dun. Dun, dun, dun. That's the first thing that came to mind when I heard that. Could you play it again?
Play it a little bit longer. Play it a little bit longer. Yeah.
There's a sample right here.
Oh. Mm. If it had, oh damn, I can't think of it.
And it's short because of clearance, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure you know. You don't want to get the copyright strikes.
Go ahead, play it. Play the.
Straight up, nigga. Motherfucking shout shot, nigga. Where we at? What? We're going to do it just like this, man. Straight
wow. Yeah.
Shout out to Onyx.
Yeah.
Wow.
Big shout out to Onyx.
Wow, that's man.
Shout out to Ricky Fragile Bax right now. He's actually touring with
Sticky Fingers.
Him.
Yeah.
Wow. So, next.
Wow,
next
man. I want to go outside in the rain.
Mm-hmm.
That's
the original.
That's the original.
Yeah, the original.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I'm trying to think of the...
That's some good Sunday music, too.
Yeah, it is.
I think actually that same record,
yeah.
They used two samples for that record to make that one record that we're about to play.
Mm. I can't think off the top of my head, like, what the...
That's cool. Play it.
The sample came... Yeah.
The original.
The sample.
You want to play the sample? No.
Want to
play the sample?
Play the song. You want to hear the sample again or you want to?
No, you could play the song.
Play the song,
yeah.
Right.
sounds like damn.
Let it play.
That's the song. That's the song they took a sample.
Yeah.
You mentioned this back earlier.
You gotta know who this is.
Oh, Wu-Tang.
Cold World.
Gotcha. Y'all going deep.
Yeah.
We got M Square.
Y'all going deep. Hey. Yeah.
All right. Next one.
I know that one. It was Jay, right?
No.
Didn't Jay use that?
No.
Oh, God. I know that one, though.
Do it again. Listen to the drums.
Yeah. Oh, man. I know that sample. I just can't think of the
Yeah, once you hear the song,
you're gonna... like, oh, really?
Yeah. I just swore Jay used that on something, but...
All right, play the song.
Oh, God, man. Warning?
I was going to say drums. These are drums.
Yeah. Biggie, Warning. Yeah, rest in peace, Biggie.
Yes.
All right, play the next joint.
Ooh. Man, you got... Yeah, these are good. Play it again. Oh man. No, I can't. It's not coming to me. I don't know why. Wow, is that the Firm?
No, it's actually out on the Piranha.
The Kaluminati.
Oh, the Kaluminati mixtape. Wow.
He went deep for that one.
That was super.
We got M Squared.
Track 13 on.
Yeah, album filler.
Yeah, man.
I wouldn't have got that one either. After you hear it, you're like, oh, shit. Like,
that's all good.
Yeah. I do play these before you get here and try to get done. And be like, yeah, no, is that it?
Yeah, we don't get them right every time either. So there's just so much music, you know what I mean?
There is.
It was like that guy, I don't remember, on MTV. He was a bald-headed dude in the 90s.
Matt Pinfield, you talking about?
I think that's his name, but he used to know every song and the year it was released.
Wow, I think I know what you're talking about.
They used to always test them like on the air, and I'm sorry, I can't remember his name, but... Talk about an encyclopedia of music.
Wow.
Like, it didn't matter what genre or whatever. He knew the artist and the year it was released and the title of the song.
Wow. You know who's also like that, too, is Questlove. Like, his knowledge of music is insane.
Yeah, I would love to see them on Beat Shazam.
Yeah, like, insane, man. You know what I mean? Know who recorded this, what year they recorded it, why, you know, how they were feeling the day they came in the studio.
What their inspiration was.
Deep.
Yeah, man.
Question. Best hip hop movie?
Ooh. To me.
For you, yeah.
Brown Sugar.
Okay.
That's probably one of my favorite movies of all time.
Right. That's one that I see on TV and I don't change the channel.
Right.
Every time.
Yeah.
I have it on DVD and streaming.
Right.
Like, I had to buy it twice. That's literally like my favorite movie of all time. Brown Sugar.
You ever seen Wild Style?
Yes, but so long ago.
Right. No, I'm just asking. Just out of curiosity. Yeah, for myself, yeah. Wild Style. June Bugs is?
B Street.
Classic.
Every year.
Really?
Christmas time, I watch B Street.
Yeah.
It's a Christmas movie, by the way. You ain't know it's a Christmas movie, according to June Bug.
It is a Christmas movie.
Well, is that the time you watch it?
In the movie, it's Christmas time.
Right.
Christmas and New Year's.
So that's the official hip-hop Christmas movie.
For June Bug. Same thing like Die Hard.
It came out in November. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It came out in November.
Yeah.
November, you know, Thanksgiving, Christmas. To me, it's a Christmas movie.
It gives you that feeling every time.
Exactly. It gives you that,
you know what I'm saying?
That vibe, yeah.
That vibe. The DJing vibe.
Yeah.
The graffiti vibe.
Mm-hmm.
The break dancing. The culture.
Wow.
You know, you get to see Dougie Fresh for the first time.
Oh, man.
Right.
You know?
I might watch that shit this year on Christmas. My FaceTime June Bug. You know, we could watch B Street together.
What's together?
Oh, my goodness.
But it's a classic movie. It's a movie I've watched hundreds of times too. B Street from when I was a kid, and
man,
you know what I mean. Just
I bought it on Amazon.
Wow. So you have a streaming too?
Yeah,
I got the VHS. I got the DVD.
I want the DVD. I got the VHS.
Yeah. DVD. I don't have the streaming. So
you got to get every format of like the iconic movies that you love like that. Yeah, buy it three times.
Yeah, I have all of them from New Jack City to.
There you go.
What else? Obviously, you know, Paid in Full, which made 20 years.
I watched that last night.
New Jack City, what else? Wow. Boys in the Hood. All of those movies that kind of encompass, you know, hip hop.
My B Street movies on VHS with four other movies from HBO.
You recorded it. Oh, wow.
Remember back in the day, you could record movies from HBO?
I thought he was going to say he rented that shit from Blockbuster and never returned it.
I should have done that.
That was a thing.
Especially
when they went out of business, man.
Oh, man. There's still one left.
There's still one left in the United States. Yes.
There is?
Still,
yes. Where? I think it's in Seattle.
I've seen a documentary on it.
And people rent the movies?
Yes. Northwest. People still go there and rent movies.
It still operates as a real Blockbuster.
All the new releases that come out, they get them, and they're like a normal Friday. People go in there and they rent the movies, man.
That's crazy. I mean, nostalgia. That's a good thing, though, I guess. You know? I mean, some things they take away from us, but to have them back again.
Yeah.
I think I still got my Blockbuster card, actually.
Wow, man.
One of my old wallets. I think I still got that shit.
That's a throwback.
Yeah, because there was one in BVL.
That's just not Blockbuster. That's just busted now.
You remember the one in BVL, right, LS? The Blockbuster? That shit, I used to hit that shit. Like, there was one in BVL, and then there was one off of OBT by the Circle. You know what I mean? So if one didn't have the movie, I used to be like, go to the next one and try to catch it.
I was stuck in Point Sierra and they only had one.
Oh, man.
So they didn't have it. We didn't watch nothing. We watching shit
that's
tonight.
That's what happened.
Yeah, that was a rough time.
Yeah. Oh, the video games too, yeah. That's what happens when you live in the country.
That's
you
know what I mean?
You only get one Blockbuster.
Point Sierra before it was a country.
It was so heartbreaking to run up to like the aisle and see nothing behind the box. It was just heartbreaking.
Well, yeah, and he used to go up to the, do you have anything in the return?
Yeah, in the return bin.
I saw somebody drop some movies in there.
I got my popcorn. I got my
free popcorn, right?
Yeah.
I just need the movie.
Yeah, and be upset. Yeah,
and they had that other place, was it 16,000 movies?
16,000 videos.
Videos,
Yeah. Remember that was so from Michigan.
And then the arcades, like that whole town was such an era, man. Like,
yeah.
I miss a lot of that. You know,
yeah,
that
there used to be an arcade in South Chase. I don't know if y'all remember the arcade next to the movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
I used to go to that shit.
Yeah,
we had two arcades. We had that one, and we had the one by the mall.
In the Osceola Mall.
Osceola Mall.
Right.
Wow, man, I miss that era.
Yeah, those are good old days. If you could name top five DJs early, like 90s, 80s, and then top five DJs now.
Ooh, okay. So it'll be like five and five or five together?
Ten altogether.
Okay. That's hard to do. Let's see. Definitely, I'm just going to mix them all, I guess.
Yeah, no order.
The way my brain works. Kid Capri, DJ Jazzy Jeff, DJ AM, Mark Ronson, DJ Premier.
Are there any new DJs now that you've seen coming up before?
I mean, there are. I'm trying to like get through the. Okay, DJ Camillo. Oh man, I'm trying to think. Like,
I think that was five.
That's like six. I think that's
five or six. Any up and coming now that you've seen, like new DJs?
Let me see. I really like locally or
new. Yeah, yeah.
I like Classic.
Okay.
DJ Classic is dope.
From Orlando.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's from here.
The producer.
Yeah.
The ex-producer.
Right. Yeah. Let me see. I'm like drawing a blank, man. I'm trying to think. You guys like edit all this out, I guess.
No,
like
the
dead,
good.
The dead air.
It's quiet.
Let me see.
Who else you got?
I like DJ 22 as well. He's dope. I've heard him a couple of times. Arsonist.
Okay.
Is dope.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to keep it local to show, you know, show that love, yeah. You know. That's important, especially coming from Orlando, mm-hmm. not being known as like a city of DJs or a city right. of that type of, you know. I want to shine light on these guys here locally that I can think of off the top of my head. There's more, but these are the guys that like stick out to me off the top. Oh man, let me see.
You could pick somebody else. Don't have to be. No, whatever you're feeling.
Yeah.
A DJ that you see an event for, and you're gonna say, "Yeah, I'm gonna go. Definitely go to that."
DJ Irie.
Okay.
For sure. Let me see. I'd also say Diplo, as well.
Yep.
And let me see if I can think of like one more. Black Coffee.
Okay.
Black Coffee is nice.
Yeah.
And Mark Farina, another one. Mm-hmm. Incredible house DJ. I've actually had the honor of seeing him live. Mm-hmm. And the way he throws down that like Jack and House stuff and the deep house and the down tempo mushroom jazz stuff that mm-hmm. he does is just mind blowing, man. It just puts you in such a zone.
Right.
Both live and when you're just listening, to listen, mm-hmm. he knows how to put you in a zone.
Right.
And that's what I love to see a DJ be able to do, you know, as a listener, as a fan of music. I like when the DJ can put me in a zone and take me where he's, you know, on his journey. Like,
right, right.
I want to see where he's going. And yeah.
So say you work in the studio, somebody calls you to do a gig that Saturday night or that Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
You produce and you can't do it. What DJ will you call to take your place?
To cover for you.
And you can't call Nasty because Nasty's on tour.
Right.
Well,
who do you trust with your crowd? And you can say, who would you trust?
Well, let me see. I mean,
I don't know. He got a deep roller there.
Yeah, there's a few. I mean,
but this is local. He's here in Orlando.
Yeah, you're here in Orlando. Oh, and they call you for something in Orlando.
Somewhere in Orlando. Like I said, we're going to show love to the city.
Yeah, man, so, absolutely. I like Classic.
Okay.
For that, he kind of gets the vibe. We've actually collaborated recently,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and I see how he gets the crowd, how he understands the audience and the mix of a crowd.
I did Classic his first gig.
Yeah, he did.
Really? Oh, yes. Much respect, man.
A couple weeks he was DJing for this hookah lounge we had.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Dope. That's awesome.
And I think really him also cool. His first placement also.
Oh, that's yeah.
And stuff like that.
Look at that. Yeah. Small world, yeah. Man. Yeah. Yeah, it's big history. Big up the Classic, yeah. Man.
Yeah, we have a lot of people that we gave their first to. We just don't talk about it.
We don't talk about it.
We
talk about it once in a while. You know what I'm saying?
You got to floss.
You have to. It's important for the culture.
Because I was going to tell you, I mean, you can't call Nasty. You can't call me incorrect because we're doing podcasts.
Right.
So,
yeah.
So who are you going to pick?
That's such a good question.
Shout out to DJ Classic.
Yeah, for sure.
Classic. You know, I'll tell you a funny story about Classic. So
okay.
About like last month, my family... My mom's side of the family is Jehovah's Witness. So
okay.
they don't celebrate, you know, birthdays or anything like that, but they do celebrate like wedding anniversaries and things like that, right? So
So
me and my wife show up and I see Classic DJing.
Oh,
right?
Cool.
So my cousin's wedding anniversary that was, you know, my blood cousin. We don't look alike. You would never know that we're cousins unless you know that we're cousins. So
yeah.
I kind of creep up on him from the back. I'm like, yo, what's up? He's like, oh my God, what are you doing here? He was like, no, I'm nervous. Like, you know what I mean? I was like, no, don't worry about it. I was like, no, this is my family. Like, you didn't know, but this is my blood family. Like,
wow.
You know, they call them family too,
mm-hmm.
within the, you know, in the Jehovah's Witness and the congregation and things like that. But I was like, this is my family. I'm not here, you know, as I got invited because I know them, you know what I mean?
Yes.
I was like, no, don't worry about it, man. You just do your thing. Right. You know, I'm not, you know, I mean, I'm not here to stress you out or anything like that. Have fun and do what you do type of thing. But
right. Yeah.
He got nervous.
On
for
your story, I just say he played some record like,
he played some crazy.
Shake your ass, girl. Make that pussy.
No, what? No, he didn't do nothing like that.
Good.
That kind of story. No. He was going.
No.
That would be Classic from back in the days.
Back in the days. Right? No, but he did what he was supposed to do. And I told him not to be nervous, man. I'm not here to make you nervous. I'm just here to, you know, pay my respects to you, let you know I'm here and salute you.
Yeah, every time I see him in the crowd and DJing, or I just go to a spot he's DJing, or he sees me, he be like, what's today's problem? No, you're good. I'm not here to judge you. Go ahead.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
No, man. I mean,
that, classic. You suck.
Oh man.
I do it on purpose.
Just
to. So when I tell him that, he knows I'm joking with him. He knows that it's a blessing. I'm actually blessing him. You know what I'm saying? By saying you suck, right. I'm blessing him. You know what I'm saying? That's how we see each other like that. You know?
Right.
Yeah.
And he surprises me every time. Every time he's different.
Yeah. And
he
surprises
me. He's just.
I think that's just something.
He found his. Like I said, he was a producer.
Uh huh.
And I think he found the DJing thing and just ran with the DJing thing. Like, forget about producing right now. I'm gonna go with this DJ thing.
Absolutely.
He's getting a lot of love in the city now.
That's absolutely.
A
good thing.
I think it's part of our culture too. You know, the Latino and the Black community and stuff like that. Like we kind of go in on each other on our faults.
Yeah. I mean, like, I gave him his first gig.
Right.
You know, first couple of gigs.
Wow,
amazing. So basically, I'm entitled to tell him you suck.
Well, if there's one to do it.
Huh? No, he's a great producer too. Yeah. He is.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And that, and again, like you're talking about the moment where he sees someone that he respects, you know, behind him. You know, it's a high honor. You know, same. It reminds me of when I was also coming up here in Orlando, and I'm DJing at, back in the day, it was Glow Lounge. So shout out to Jay Johnson and Point Blank and Wall G and all of these, you know, guys that really, really built that vibe here in Orlando for the city.
Right.
I was DJing one night at Glow with Point Blank, and you know, it's like peak of the night, and I'm vibing, the crowd's doing their thing, and I kind of look over my shoulder, and DJ Nasty's right there.
Mm-hmm.
And at this point, I had never met him yet, but I've had this, you know, he's a DJ hero of mine.
Right.
So as I couldn't believe it. I was like,
right, you see the little, guy 5 feet tall.
I couldn't believe it. I'm here DJing. To my right, I see DJ Nasty just watching. Like, it was just such an honor, man. Like, I stopped what I was doing, turned around, gave my respects,
of course,
and everything. And it's just like, so I know that feeling,
right,
when someone you highly respect is in the room,
yeah,
as you're doing your thing. All you're hoping for is that you get. They're not
the
approved.
Knowledge, right.
You know,
their
you
attention
get
too.
That.
And
yeah. You get their attention. You get that you did your thing at the end of the night. You know what I mean? As as a fellow DJ, I totally relate to that moment.
Yeah. Yeah. Nasty used to do Wednesdays at Taboo.
I remember that.
It was me and Nasty and Pro Style.
Yes.
He used to do Wednesdays. And one day he couldn't do it, and he gave me the call.
Oh.
So I was able to do, you know, Taboo for him on a Wednesday one time.
Very nice.
And it was dope. Yeah, it was dope. You know, I love those things like that. I used to do it too for Wild G on Saturdays when he used to have Saturdays there. So when he was traveling at that time, I think it was Pepsi. Or Coke?
I think so.
I think it was Pepsi that he had a sponsorship deal with them, or he was collaborating with them on something. And every once in a while, he would have to travel out of the country or whatever it is. And and I would cover for Wild G there also.
Yeah, man. Much respect, Wild G.
It was Beecham. I don't know what the hell it was called, but. Same club, different name type of thing.
Yeah.
But those are always great calls, you know what I mean?
Absolutely. So, and speaking of that, like those moments here coming up in Orlando, I have to give a big shout out to Pat Nix and Willie Fisher. They were a major part of my journey as well, growing here as a DJ and doing some of the most like iconic parties here.
Yeah,
like,
I remember
when you were at Whispers and stuff like that.
And Rain and First Fridays with Frontline Promotions and that entire team. So I have to say thank you to Pat Nix and Willie Fisher and the whole Frontline team, Christina Clark and, you know, just everybody that was a part of that journey from day one with me and watching me grow and giving me that platform, that opportunity to perform with people like Idris Elba and you know, Chrisette Michelle and Questlove. Even I got to collaborate with Questlove, you know, through that experience as well. So there's so many great memories here just from Orlando itself, you know, just has been really like, you know, humbling, you know, as a major part of my journey. Again, Jay Johnson, you know, Bernard Florima, man, just so many people that have kind of like architected the party scene here of Orlando.
Yeah.
You know, these guys are the architects.
Yep.
Hands down, you know.
Yeah, dope. So what are you working on now? What do we have to forward, you know, to look forward to coming from M Squared?
Man, so it's just a lot of private events, corporate events coming up. Mm-hmm. Also, I have a special set of residency dates actually coming up with Mangoes.
Okay. Okay, we were just there last week with, with Pat Nix actually doing the Kid Capri show.
Nice, yeah, nice. Yeah. Very nice. And so I'll be there. My first date will be November 11th.
Okay.
So I'm excited, looking forward to that.
Night?
Yes, I believe it's a Friday
Wolfpack
night. Then. So I believe so, yes.
Wolfpack,
so,
yeah. Shout out to Wolfpack, matter of fact. P1 Vodka out there.
Yes, sir.
Man,
one
so,
of our sponsors.
Yeah, the entire crew there. Great, great crew. And also a lot more production mm-hmm. work. Like I said, I just dropped my new single, City, mm-hmm. featuring Viper and Abeck. So definitely stream that. I'm going to hear some instrumental projects from me, as well as more social media content mm-hmm. Around what I've, DJ-wise, what I love.
Right.
You know, and just, yeah, continuing to further the brand, more traveling, mm-hmm. More international dates and things like this are also coming up as well. Yeah, and yeah. The Remy Martin DJ Collective, mm-hmm. you know. Continuing to yeah. spread the name and the brand.
Yeah, so we putting that out there too. I'm not gonna yeah. say if because I don't like to use if well, like that's if. Negative, right?
Right?
So when you do the Remy Martin collaborative when you guys do an event in Orlando, me and Jewbug would like to,
yes.
you know, attend that.
Oh, y'all
event.
Are in there, yes, no right. question.
You know what I mean?
Respect the DJs are gonna be in the
we
building.
We gotta be
yes.
there to check it out.
100%.
Make sure I get my good clothes out for
yes.
that.
There you go. Suit and tie. Yeah,
suit
know?
And tie. I gotta show up right.
Suit and tie.
I mean?
No Tims. I'm a Tim man.
Jewbug might try to get in with Tims, but I'll make sure he brings.
They got dressy Tims now.
I'll make
they
sure
do.
He brings dressy
they
Tims.
They do have dressy
I got a pair.
Tims.
I got a pair.
And Junebug definitely has a pair. I know he has.
They got dressy Tims now.
What's dressy Tims? I never seen.
I'll take them out.
I never seen.
Poppy shampoo.
I'm some shampoo? Poppy shampoo ones.
Yes.
I gotta see some yes. dressies. I never seen no dressy ass Tims.
After the podcast, I'm gonna show you my poppy shampoo.
Don't come out here with some patent leather, some patent leather Tims.
So N Square, before we yeah. leave, if you was driving from here to New York to do a gig, you had only 10 albums to pick on your travels.
Ooh.
What 10 albums would that be?
Ooh, 10.
Just 10. You got your CD deck in the trunk.
Yeah.
And you're about to pop in the 10 CDs.
Hmm.
What are they?
Well, I've named a few of them already. So Groove Theory, mm-hmm. the Groove Theory first album. Again, Who is Jill Scott?
Mm-hmm.
Music Soul Child, I Just Want to Sing.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Jackson, Thriller.
Mm-hmm.
Mark Ronson's Version album.
Okay.
Mark Farina, all the Mushroom Jazz albums, okay. all of them. Okay. If I could just put all the Gangstar albums in one thing, I'll do that too. Like every Gangstar album, incredible. Super classic. Let's see.
You got two more?
Yeah, you're in Virginia right now. You're in Virginia.
Yeah, you bought DC.
Yeah.
Virginia. You know where they got the speed traps and all that.
Uh-huh.
So don't put nothing too crazy because you might.
And you know they got the go-go music.
And they
too.
Got the go-go yeah. music, absolutely.
Let's see. I'd have to say Glenn Lewis, World Outside My Window.
Mm-hmm.
Jeez. These are like.
You got one more. You bought Jersey right now.
Yeah. Just getting in there.
You're just getting in there.
You on that turnpike.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. Jay-Z Reasonable Doubt, man. Mm-hmm. Jay-Z Reasonable Doubt. That's a must. That's for sure. Yeah, I think that's 10, right?
That's about 10.
That's about 10, yeah.
Either
about
9
10.
Or 10, somewhere around there.
So,
yeah,
N Square, when we first introduced you earlier, I didn't want to put the word DJ in front of your name because I see you more than a DJ. We actually see you more than a DJ.
Right,
thank
so
you,
so we
want
to put just the word DJ. Not saying that we're against the DJ because we're about the DJs, but
yes,
I felt when we were actually looking at your resumes, is beyond a DJ.
Man, thank you. That means a lot coming from y'all, man. Thank you.
You know, it's honored. Beyond a DJ, so I didn't want to put the word DJ and stuff like that. So we salute you.
Thank you. Salute y'all, man.
Stuff like that.
Thank you.
Any final words to our listeners and viewers?
Just thank you guys for all the support. And, you know, look out for more coming from M Squared, man. Thank you guys for the platform, for having me today. And this is a very, very dope podcast, man.
Great concept, man.
I'm glad to be here.
If anybody wanted to book you or you know, get you, how would they reach out to you?
Yes, djmsquared.com to book.
Okay.
Accepting bookings worldwide, so djmsquared.com.
You do your own bookings?
So I have a management team.
Okay.
So they handle a lot of that. Okay. And, yeah, djmsquared.com.
Dope.
Great.
Any last things? Final words or anything?
Just thank you, man. I'm just super grateful and honored to be doing what I love to do for a living. And, you know, I never take that for granted.
Dope.
So before we leave, we'd like to salute to also P1 Vodka, Lou. We need more vodka. We're running out. You know what I'm saying? One of our sponsorships right there. Also, Chew Leaf, hold on, let me get this real quick. Making smoking easier. Chew Life. Chew Leaf, not Chew Life.
Shout out to Chew Life.
But you have to do like, I need you as a, we need it in the podcast as well.
And we need a verse.
We need a verse. We actually need two verses. Stuff like that. Can we take us out?
Yep. So many thanks to you, our loyal listeners. And as always, we have another exciting episode coming up. Stay tuned. And until then,
I've been your host, DJ Junebug, alongside DJ Kareg, and we out. Peace. Out
like light.
Peace.
Street Dreams Music Group. Play that. Play that. Play that.
DJ Scoobs began DJing at the young age of 13. His passion for music and dedication to the craft has inspired many, and his hard work and talent has taken him far. To playing gigs and clubs all over the United States, he has shown that with determination and talent, anything is possible. DJ Scoobs' unique style and ability to read the crowd have made him a sought-after DJ, and his love for music continues to shine through in every set he played. DJ Scoob's journey is a testament to the power of pursuing dreams, and his success serves as an inspiration to aspiring DJs everywhere. DJ Scoob's, you have shown that with hard work, talent, and a love for what you do, anything is possible. DJ Scoob's, Respect the DJs podcast, salutes you.